Welcome to the roundtable event that we've got organised for Men's Mental Health Day, which is the 19th of November. I'm part of the wellbeing team and I've got a selection of colleagues with me today. I'm just going to ask everybody to introduce themselves.
Shall I start? Yeah. My name's Norman, one of the mental health wellbeing advisors within the team.
I'm Greg, I'm one of the wellbeing advisors here at Sunderland University. I help with things like anxiety, depression, low mood and lots of other stuff as well.
And I'm Steven. I work with Wellbeing Unit as a professional light officer, basically trying to get the other ethnic minority student closer to the services, and that's what I do here.
And I'm Dave. I'm one of the counsellors here that works at the university in the wellbeing team. I want to start the discussion off by asking, what would be a really good way to engage men in mental health?
I think we're difficult, right? We're difficult to engage in different services. It's hard to get us into places. There's a lot of pressure that men have on from other men themselves and from society in itself. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we've got to adapt to the situation in getting men into us, because we're I think it's 2-1 in services. Men are the one in that. 36% I think likely to engage compared to
it's
women.
It's a conversation, isn't it? The start of a conversation. How does that conversation begin?
But I think that's really important. Yeah. I think part of the conversation has to be around men come in lots of different identities, lots of different roles, and I think it's really important that we kind of deconstruct some of that and, you know, have that plurality in terms of what we mean by men as well, because often we may have one, you know, aspect of that, and I think that's sometimes not necessarily helpful as well.
As for me, I'll say we should try to identify each individual for their personality and, you know, see what might come across as interesting to them to talk about. Yeah, what platform are we meeting them? So creating that sense of belonging, that sense of environment that really makes them want to talk. Yeah, so I think it's just begin with identifying each individual as for their personality. Yeah.
Do you think it's tricky? Do you think it's like...
Absolutely, yeah. Some men like to do it one-to-one. Some men like to do it in groups. I think, again, it's the individual that wants to do it. Men are more likely to come online for online support, again, but that's because are we less willing to talk about our issues and talk about our problems? And I think there is causing that, because there is a reluctance to appear vulnerable. And again, that may be cultural, that may be societal, but that may be as an individual as well. You don't want to be perceived to have any sort of weakness. Now, you can go into long-term historically, is that how we are brought up, not to be weak, to be strong mentally, to be that person, to be the provider, and then asking for help, asking support, is that going against what we're brought up
to? Are you saying it's like a toxic cloak of masculinity, and what we're trying to do is to perhaps take that cloak off and say you can be who you want to be, but I guess that comes with challenges in terms of like how do we as a service, how do we as a university make it inclusive, make it accessible? If you're referring to some of the issues about low take-up of services, which is a kind of universal, I think it's mirrored in the outer wider society as well, in terms of like less males accessing GP practice, less males accessing counselling, etc., etc.
I mean, there could be some like environmental factors as well. If you think about families that grow up in a masculine sort of, predominantly masculine, you know, that message of boys don't cry. I grew up with that stuff, you know, and I found it difficult, you know, getting older. That message is quite a strong message. Is that something that you've that you've experienced?
I can, you know, you're saying that I can relate with that very well from the background I come from and where it's like abnormal to see a male child cry. And it's really abnormal to see a male child complain about things that regular girl child we complain about. So so the stigma to men breaking down, really expressing themselves emotionally, the challenge is there, and everyone is raised to be tough, strong, dominant.
It's interesting what you're saying there, Stephen. So you're talking about the language as well, how to express ourselves, like depending on one's like, you know, vocabulary, they might have that emotional vocabulary in terms of like the right words to convey the right emotions if we haven't been brought up in that environment. So I think something like World Mental Health Day, it's very much about that. It's about bringing it to the fore and finding ways of having conversations with your friends, family, whoever, your workplace, colleagues, about it. So it's one special day, but it shouldn't just rest within one day.
I mean, that's a really good point. I mean, that takes me on to my next point of asking, what is Men's Mental Health Day? What's it all about?
Yeah. I think Men's Mental Health Day, it's a really positive message, isn't it? It's about getting people to engage into the service, about getting men to talk about men, whatever way that is, to each other or to services, and whatever they like, whatever they prefer. Mm-hmm. And it is. It's because we're a hidden minority in mental health services. Yeah. And I know there's different minorities even within that, if you're talking about LGBT people and different ethnic minorities as well. There's something that needs to be looked at and something where we need to learn how to engage with men. And I think World Mental Health Day is doing that, is shining a light almost on what we need to do to help men.
Yeah.
I think that's really important, because I think one of the elephants in the room, which we haven't really talked about yet, is around suicide. Right. Because that's one of the big, you know, things the campaign's around, and it's around how do we, you know, reduce some of that unfortunate, you know, fatalities in terms of suicide. Yeah. And I think that's a focus that the university is keenly wants to address. Yeah. So we're part of the Serial Suicide Alliance, and we're part of Suicide Prevention Alliances. So on different levels within the university, there's a lot of policies and actual resources put in terms of reducing, you know, our suicides.
Speaking of suicide, I just take up a couple of data and I realized that about over 5,500 plus suicide rates in UK for the past couple of years, and 3/4 of this data shows that men are really like the majority of the numbers. So it's really quite alarming to see that men are going through a lot, and
it's a staggering amount,
the society is not really giving so much attention to it. Uh-huh. Yeah. So.
And I think connected to that as well, Stephen, is within local areas, you know, in geographical areas, I think the North East has got one of the high levels of hotspots and suicide as well.
It increases when poverty's around. Yeah. So I think that's what it's hard to do with demographics. Absolutely. Age is huge. I think it's 40 to 50. That age range for suicide is huge in men. But I think you can look at a life cycle then as well. At that age, that can be when families have broken down, where men are becoming more isolated. And I think that's a big key in the suicide rate as well, the lack of support and the lack of accessing it.
It is also around young people as well. So young men are featured highly as well. And I think it's largely around today's society. I think we're living like a consumer capitalist society insofar as you're defined by what you do, and I would say arguably by what you earn. And therefore, I think for a lot of men, you know, if they're not, you know, got a job, or they're struggling in terms of like finding out what they're going to do in life, or their experience changes along the, as you say, the life cycle, I think that can lead to crises. And I think it's again connected to the to that toxic kind of masculine role and identity as the breadwinner. And I think society's morphed, it's changed from there, but it's like, how do we manage that transition?
So thinking about that in terms of how do men approach mental health differently? Do you think different people, how do you think men approach mental health differently?
Can I just share a personal experience? When I was a teenager, I had significant anxiety, and for some reason, I didn't access it. And I think, one, I perhaps didn't know where the service was. And secondly, perhaps it's that sense of like, oh gosh, I have to cope on my own do it.
Yeah.
You know, so that's just a personal experience, but also working professionally with men, I've seen that once they come in a room, it's still that stigma, it's still that fear of what's going to happen.
Yeah. See, for me, I suffered with stress absolutely massively when I was a teacher, and I did not access support until I feel now, looking backwards on it, that it was too late at that time to do that. And I think men do that. We will put off, we don't need support, I don't need to access that support. And we'll find a lot then of reaching men at maybe even the beyond point at that time when they're in crisis. Yeah. Because you think as a man, I can do this. Yeah. I've got this all the time. I don't need anyone else to help me. I don't need to rely. And you'll take on all those problems. You'll take that weight on your shoulders.
What about peer pressure? Do you think there's in the workplace, you know, you think of different STEM jobs, different male-orientated workforces. Do you think there's...
You know, not so much in the jobs that I've been involved in, not so much in the teaching, not so much in the probation service that I was in as well. And I would say the services that I were in were more female-dominated, though, than male-dominated. So it would be interesting to hear that from a more male-dominated environment, because I perceive the pressures would be there. Coming from the probation service, though, there was a different pressure there. As a man in that, I wasn't allowed to work with women. Male probation officers aren't allowed to work with women because we're seen as their stress, we're seen as their pressure, we're seen as the augment of their reality of crime, where it's not seen the other way around as that, so women are allowed to work with men. So it's interesting the different pressures that we have within those working environments and how, often looking at that, that is how men are perceived.
Yeah.
As the results of trauma, as the perpetrators of trauma to others.
Uh-huh. What about a traditional role of a man? Do you think that's like still around? The male traditional role?
I'll say, it's something that we find very difficult to get over. Mm. Like the gender assignment, the gender role play a man has to, the fact that a man, the word man itself, man up, come on, be a man. The word itself indicate like maybe strength, dominance, you know, power, hero. Mm-hmm. So when you see the perception of people to the word man, then it rings a bell in your head, like, do you really want to live up to that or you want to be something less? Mm-hmm. But now we are sitting here and we're trying to really make people understand that it's okay for you to be a man and still struggle. Mm-hmm. It's okay for you to be a man and not be masculine, not be fierce, not be strong.
Mm-hmm. And so, it's okay to seek help as well, isn't it? Yeah, I'm struggling and it's fine and I'm going to seek help and it's nothing wrong with that. In fact, it's quite good to do that.
Yeah. So in your practice, are you finding that message is getting through, or what do you think?
No. I find that in practice it can be, but I think the world is to its own. You're getting a lot of pressure from social media on young students who are coming in, and you have people, I'm not going to mention their specific names, but who are saying to men, no, you do need to be manly, you need to be strong, you need to follow these guidelines, you need to kind of rule the roost in your house, which is a heck of a lot of pressure for any man coming along to doing that. And again, you're being told what to do, which is that, in the terms of what we want as masculinity, is that what we want as being manly, being told what to do by other people, or do we want to accept it as we can be ourselves?
Speaking of social media, I tell you, I seen a post on Instagram today, and the man just wanted to be a stay-at-home dad, and the society was, the family were like, oh, because where I come from, Nigeria, when you see a man that has really accepted to be a stay-at-home dad, to clean the house, take care of the kids, it's more like, oh, your wife is controlling you, and your wife is, you're under some kind of spell, and you've been enchanted, and you have to do the wife's bid. And it's not necessarily like that.
When the reality of that, what's the reality of that? It could be what?
The reality is the man just always feel protected around the woman. Like the woman has been the protector from way back as university. Because when I read through the story, it did refer to when they met at the university and how he was being bullied and the wife stood up for him. So he just accepted his own fate, like, oh, this is who I am, and I like the fact that my wife is my protector, and I'm okay with it. But the society tends to feel different about that.
Yes, and that's why I think, in terms of practice, uncloaking identities, first of all, just who are you as a human is really important. Yeah. So allow the person to convey who they are, and that might come in lots of different roles and identities, and that's the important part. So rather than having an assumption, it's just like, enabling that person to tell their story is really important.
Yeah. Before we come here for this, I was really running Greg through the experience of our students, international male students, and how they come in, the kind of different challenges they come in with, leaving their good jobs, the good life back in wherever they're coming from. Understand, and because their wife want them to move out, their kids want, they want a good life for their kids, and they have to move down to the UK to study. And that moment, we kind of identify that automatically in a state of stress, and which can either lead to, if it's well managed, can be positive, but if it's not well managed, can lead to depression, anxiety, and from there escalate to suicidal ideation, and you know, the worst of it.
So that's again highlighting the issues in terms of transitions, you know, whether it's starting university, you know, leaving university, you know, trying to juggle university life with jobs and parent or other care responsibilities someone may have. And I think that's a real challenge for each and everyone, isn't it?
Yeah. So with the work that we do in our team, what do you think needs to be done further, maybe to improve, or, you know, how can we put ourselves out there to sort of support men?
Well, in a, you know, more, I would say from a tumour point, we try to get a good mix of the demographics gender in our team, so it's, you know, it's visible and visibility, accessible. Visibility is really important. Accessibility in terms of, like, trying to get the information out there, how you do that, and hitting different demographics is something that we're really trying to do and be more, you know, creative about. What do you think, Rick?
Yeah, I think it is. I think we do quite a lot already. I don't know if it's seen. I know I mentioned earlier that, look, online is really important to men. Sometimes actually seeking support, you generally want to do it your first when you first do it. So we've got things like SilverCloud and TogetherAll that absolutely run online that people can get support with as well while they're going through, especially with SilverCloud. You can get SilverCloud coaching.
Are they like free and accessible?
They're absolutely free, so the university's paid into these schemes. Now, SilverCloud itself is something that's NHS based, so normally you'd have to go to your GP for it, but every single student and staff member has access to this. It's wonderful, it's fantastic, it's something I use on a daily basis when I'm working with people, but people can engage with it themselves. And I think as men, that's often what we think. Again, I said before, we want to help ourselves at first. And you know what? It is a starting point. It is. But I think it's important for us to actually tell them, look, you've got more than that. There is more to this. You've got other people helping you. You've got other people supporting you. And again, we are difficult to engage in that, because once they've done that, people go, right, I've fixed myself. I've looked at that. I've done it. I've completed it. But actually, no, in the reality, that's not going to happen. These things can come round in cycles and can come on again.
I think it's like that an African proverb, it takes a village to raise a child. So it's all right to do some of the self-help stuff, but there's also support there as well, whether that's in the university or in primary care, or, you know, other services, you know, like Mind, Samaritans, you know, your GP. There's a whole plethora of services out there that someone could access.
And we've got a really good targeted campaign going on at this for the whole of November, which focuses on different aspects of, you know, mental health, men's mental health. And everybody's welcome to get involved in that. And you mentioned something about staff earlier on, and the male staff or any staff members in the university, the support for staff members, and that is in through the counselling service. So we're available to support.
For me, I think we're leaving something out, and it's really something positive about what we're doing so far. And that's the fact that we have a men's group.
I was just going to ask. There's two, isn't there? There's a staff one.
There's a staff one that's just started a few weeks ago, and that's going really well. Apparently,
it's really, really, like, because I like the fact that we're trying to bring up, like, video game session.
It's on a Wednesday at 1 o'clock, and it's just a general talking group that we do, isn't it? It's fantastic, but the way men engage is different. And men like to do things, don't we? So we don't necessarily just sit and have a general chat. You don't go out for coffees normally as much. I still do as much with friends as you find that women will. Yeah. So men like to go and they like to play games together. They like to play cards together, video games, whatever it is. And then the conversations flow. And the conversation isn't part of it.
Good conversations.
It is, yeah.
Like, yes, because people don't know that they're talking at that point. So it's their mind is away from that. And they discuss things more freely. And you'll understand more and you'll get more from them when you're doing that with men.
Yeah, so the group is there. And something I couldn't really appreciate again is the friendship evening. Because I've been attending. I think the chaplain is really doing good with that. And I've attended a couple of...
Is that on a Wednesday evening, is it?
Yeah, Wednesday evenings again.
7 to 9, isn't it?
Yeah, you see, you get to play sort of games, board games, and talk.
Chris, does he still do pizza? I think he used to do pizza.
Yeah.
He used to, I don't
know. Yeah. And some of that is still part of what the SU organised, the five-a-side tournament. Yeah, that just had its play last week.
So it's not just, it's a whole ecosystem of support around the university, isn't it, with different services.
But that's what's important too, your mental health, isn't it? It's not it's not just the come and access us as support. It's where mental health support predominantly, but it's go and access friendship groups,
go
and access financial support, go and access disability support, go and access progression support. There's so many support networks here for people to engage into that people don't immediately realise because they don't go out and seek these things. So it is, it's really good that these groups are available. And you know what? One of the best ways to advertise is word of mouth.
Yeah.
And we found that with the men's group as well.
That's right.
Men bring other men in.
Bringing other people in.
I find the sports teams will do that as well. They've got wellbeing champions from the SU, and I think that's a great way to engage with men and say, actually, no, we're here for each other. We're here to support. Yeah. And people are more likely to engage and talk because of
and
that.
In the groups that we've been running on the Wednesday, the numbers are growing, aren't they? They are growing. Easy, and it does feel like a really protected space. That's what I feel from it. Mm-hmm. Like when they all get together and they're all pinching the donuts.
Yes, yeah.
It does feel like a protected time. It does.
Yeah.
As in, you know, we're all lads together, you know, and we're all chatting away.
Yeah.
But it does feel like a good space.
And the conversation's not just about mental health.
No, it's not. That's right. Which is important.
Absolutely important. It's about, I mean, we were talking films and video games last week.
So it's seeing the person in its holistic view, isn't it?
Yeah. But it makes us, I think, seem more approachable as well. I've had people in that come to me and talk about their mental health issues afterwards and then had sessions with them afterwards because of what they've been in the men's group. And again, that's for men. Seeing that safety is really important. So me, Dave and I will suddenly be seen as, oh, actually, they're just blokes. I can go and talk to them. They're not mental health professionals. In that sense, that's not a barrier.
It's like getting over that barrier, isn't it? It's breaking down the barrier by an approach that's quite different.
Yeah. So the month, November month, I want to stress that it's a month to get involved for men. With the different events that are on, there's one, it's every Wednesday. I mean, you'll have to look out on the website for the dates, but it's every Wednesday in the afternoon. There's something different. I want to encourage people to come along and get involved, you know. Yeah. Tips, advice, anybody got any for blokes that you try to engage in? Or?
Yeah, I just want to share part of my experience on the conference I attend on Saturday, Community Men and Trauma, that's a conference, and so it was really impactful, and I did realize a lot about men's mental health. There were panel discussion about intersections of men from, basically it was black, so intersection between the sexualities, the gay black men, the black queer men, you know, the LGBT men and all of that. They were there and they shared their lived experiences and the kind of advice on going forward, what they think can be done better. Yeah. And more like it is black men that has been on maybe mental health detention, institution and all of that, and now they're out of the system and they're trying to start over again. Their experiences and how difficult they find it starting all over again, and because the stigma still remains. Yes. Yeah, the stigma remains and it keeps them from really assessing maybe jobs, good jobs, keeps them from assessing maybe a union like this that they would want to be part of.
I think it's interesting you say, because in terms of black men and black men in LGBT plus, is they're often some of the most marginalised ones in what that conference I imagine was about. It's like talking about it, you know, being able to have that forum, that medium to like express oneself, but also making services such that they can access it as well is really important, because when you were saying before, Greg, there's a whole range of different identities in marginalised groups, and I think it's about how can we therefore be creative. So one of my tips is early intervention, whatever it is you're struggling with, just really try to find someone, an ally. Mm-hmm. It doesn't have to be someone who's like a professional. It could be your mate, it could be a family member, it could be someone, you know, in the university, you know, who's, you know, security. It could be anyone out there, just to talk, you know. It's good to talk and get out there early, I would say. That's one of my tips.
Yeah. Being able to admit vulnerability is, in fact, an incredible strength to be able to do that, to say, to look, to ask, I need help. On a professional level, we'd do it every day. We'd say, oh, I've got this to do. I've got this little problem. I'd go and find some sort of expert to help me. But that doesn't necessarily help when people have the mental health issues. They kind of internalise those things. So I'd say, try not to do that. Seek that support, seek that help. And that is true strength in doing that, to ask for help.
Yeah. How do they ask wellbeing then? How do they come into wellbeing for help? roots in?
Oh, God, lots of roots. So you can self-refer, for example, on our website.
Yeah.
You can walk in. So we have physical locations. Yeah. It's St. Peter's and it's City Campus, Monday to Friday, 9 to 5.
Yeah.
Similarly, we have an out-of-hours service as well, between 6:30 in the evening and 6:30 in the morning, where if you need to speak to one of our colleagues in that team, and they can help with in terms of like accessing. But as you say, one of the good words is online. Do you want to say a bit more?
Yeah, no, Silver Cloud is absolutely fantastic. So you can access Silver Cloud anytime you want, anytime you want online. But also we do other things with Silver Cloud. I mentioned coaching before. So if someone needs a bit more support throughout that, they can get a practitioner like myself or like one of my colleagues.
Oh, so you could do like give them a call one-to-one, talk them through that sort of thing.
Yeah, and you know what? It's not straightforward for everyone.
Right,
and some people prefer it that way as well. Some people say, actually, I need to talk through these things I'm working through. I can have a look at my journal that I'm working on through it and can we talk about these things? And I can lead them into other parts of Silver Cloud, because Silver Cloud itself is like a treasure trove of different help and different support bits that are in it.
Yeah.
But yeah, you can get absolutely online.
I think that's important, isn't it? Because it's that stigma of offering someone an online service and then letting them go away and do it.
Yeah.
How often are they going to say, oh, it's just an online?
Yeah.
That support's fantastic, where you know you can actually work through it with them, talk them through it, sign them up, and then point them in the right direction.
And I'd like to say with our service as well that in any part of it, you can request, because I think now we have men in every single part of it, you can request a man.
Ah, right.
And I think that's a very important thing to offer,
a
very safe thing for everyone to have. We've got male counsellors, we've got wellbeing support, we've got mental health support as well, which is important when engaging into a service, because not everywhere, from what we've worked through and what we've experienced beforehand, can offer that just with staffing levels.
Yeah.
Just to emphasise a little on Project Shining Light, which is what I represent, Project Shining Light is actually an opportunity to bridge the gap between other ethnic minority students from, could be Africa, both home and international, could be from Africa, could be from Asia, could be from the James Traveller, the Boatman, the Caribbean, and all sorts of other ethnic minority, to really know that the services is available for them to assess, and you know, if they find any doubts with you, they can speak to me, they can get in touch, and I'll refer them to wonderful people in the team, and just to build the trust with students from all these backgrounds, and reassure them again that the university is doing so much to provide
support. So I just want to say thank you to my colleagues for turning up for this discussion today. It's been very informative. And just a message to everyone that's watching, if you are struggling right now and you need some support right now, come and speak to us at Wellbeing. Don't stay with it. Don't let it sit. Don't sit on your hands with it. Come and speak to us.